And now, the man you're about to meet is one of those ambiguous yet magical figures who have decorated British life since the time of Shakespeare. One thinks of Puck in A Midsummer Night's Dream. One thinks of Oscar Wilde. One thinks of selling millions of records and becoming Britain's hottest pop export since the Beatles. And he hasn't finished yet. Here's a new one.
Mother clutches the head of a dying son. Anger and tears. So many things to feel. Sam should have fought good with his hands. No one mentions the unmentionable, but everybody understands. Here in this cold white room, tied up to these machines, it's hard to imagine him as he used to be. Laughing, screaming, tumbling free, like the most amazing light show that you've ever seen. Whirling, swirling, never blue. How could you go and die? What a lonely thing to do.
It's Boy George. George, I thought that Brooke Greenwell's victory in that pageant was never in doubt. Who were you rooting for?
Can you imagine one of those kids coming at you with a knife? I mean, Brooke in particular. Quite scary.
And singing while she did it.
Yeah, that's right. Hey, good looking. Yeah.
Did you have a favourite? Obviously, Brooke wasn't your favourite.
I like the little fat one with the ginger hair. That was me when I was at school. <Very good. laughs> She had the best voice.
Yeah.
You see, the fat ones always have the best voices. Yeah.
You can imagine that voice, Jim. You can imagine that voice turning into something. Into a nightmare, as a matter of fact. Yeah.
If God doesn't make you perfect, he makes you talented.
Yeah, yeah. She was very cute. She had stage presence too, didn't she? Yeah.
She just couldn't be bothered, you know.
Well, you know, maybe the kids enjoy dressing up, and I think all kids do. I did. You know, I used to dress up in my mother's clothes when I was... I think all boys do. They just don't confess it afterwards.
Well, I did, and I'm quite happy to confess it.
Yeah.
But my mother had the worst wardrobe.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
She had really bad, kind of horrible eyeshadow, like this horrible kind of, you know, blue stuff.
You sort of knew all this when you were a kid. You think, oh, I don't like that Max Factor. Yeah.
I think you know very early on, because other kids tell you. Kids have this unbelievable ability to kind of poke you where it hurts, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Poof. I'm sure that never happened to you, Clive.
Well, I wasn't wearing my mother's dress in the school playground, so... Yeah.
Neither was I, but, you know, kids pick up on these things. It's like being the wounded cub in a, you know, pack.
Yeah.
They kind of pick on you. And that was my experience.
Yeah. Was your mother... was your mother, Mrs. O'Dowd, was she a good stage mum like those kids?
Not at all like that. Not at all like that. I mean, she, you know, she encouraged us to do what we wanted to do, but... really, we were all going to work for my father, because my dad was a builder, so we were all going to be builders. Yeah. But I preferred to paint and decorate myself, so...
you can't do that and be a builder. Yeah.
I guess you can, but it's pretty difficult on a site, you know.
Yeah. What were you like as a kid? Were you a show-off?
I think showing off is a way of kind of hiding insecurity, so I think I did show off, you know. I mean, being the middle child in a family of six, you tend to kind of be fighting for attention all the time, so I did show off, and I was always told not to, but of course, as you can see, it didn't work.
Were you popular at school?
You know, like in the gym where they choose a football team?
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
I was never called. It was always like, you know, I was always the last. It was actually quite painful.
Your book is very interesting, unusually interesting for a showbiz autobiography, because things have actually happened to you, not just a career. And but you were actually expelled from school, weren't you?
Well, I knew the only way to get out of there would be to be as kind of naughty and rude and bad as possible, because I really did want to leave. And that was the only way to get expelled, so I went out of my way to turn up late or to not go, and whenever I could, kind of humiliate the teachers.
Yeah. Was there physical punishment, or...?
We had the cane, or the slipper.
The slipper?
Yeah. And you could choose between your hand or your backside. They were very kind. I remember, actually, before I got expelled, I was taken to the headmaster for a good beating, and I refused, and he was saying to me, you know, take it like a man. You know, take it, you know, think of your parents, think of your future. And I was like, what has my future got to do with being beaten by you? I said, no way. And so I got sent home.
The deputy headmaster at our school, he used to cane us. He used to take a run up before he hit you.
I think he did that as well.
He'd be waiting in his office and he'd leave the office.
Get down the corridor.
Yeah, get down the corridor. He'd come in and wham. Yeah.
I think they do enjoy it because my headmaster was extremely small. He was very small. I think it kind of made him feel powerful.
Yeah, I enjoy it too damn much. That's the problem with it.
Yeah. You know?
What did you do after school?
I wanted to become like a makeup artist or something in fashion, but I ended up stuck in the shelves at Tesco's, unfortunately.
not too glam, although there are glamorous Tesco shelf
stalkers. There are, Clive. Maybe in Australia, but not in...
I'm just thinking of the audience out there, you know.
I mean, it was quite funny because I was a punk and I had, like, the hair, the spiky hair, and I used to have this gingham overall, and I used to wear odd fluorescent socks and plastic sandals, and I used to get a lot of people coming up saying, all right, Ken Dodd, all right! Because I had the hair, you know, stick your hands in a plug, did you? Had a lot of that.
Talking earlier on about the very, very big news about the Boy Scouts this week. Were you ever a scout?
I was for about 5 years. I did all the, you know, bobber job, frightening old ladies. I mean, I got all the awards for tying knots and, you know, cooking sausages and all that stuff.
You didn't modify the uniform.
I was very good with sausages, actually.
You didn't modify the uniform in any way, high heels and that sort of thing.
No. I mean, that was when I was very young, like, I mean, 6, 7, up to about 10. I was in there for a long time. I loved it. Yeah. Going off, you know, to stay in fields and tents and stuff.
I'm rotten with envy, you know, because I always wanted to be a scout and I never made it out of the Cubs. I was telling Jonathan earlier that I just didn't have what it took, you know. I mean, even when I was shaving by the time I left the Cubs, but they still wouldn't let me into the scout.
I think I appreciate the uniform more now than I did at the time, actually.
Well, it's got some pretty strange stuff on it, hasn't it? The thing on the scarf, what was that called? You know,
a boggle.
No, it's a woggle.
Oh, it was called a boggle, wasn't it?
No, a boggle is what you do when you meet Boy George. A woggle.
The boggles are
mind-boggling.
Yeah.
It's a woggle.
A woggle.
It's a woggle. It's a woggle. It's this very, very complicated thing that goes with you. You actually spent a lot of time in my hometown, in Sydney, and how do they treat you there?
Australia's always been really, really good, you know, for me. In terms of like record sales and stuff, and it's a good place to go, but it's so far.
Yeah, that's true.
I mean, you really have to kind of plan it, you know, because it's like 2 days on the plane. I was there in February, which was really good. I went there for the lesbian and gay Mardi Gras.
And they came back with you.
You know, I got shouted at in Australia. I was walking along the road, and a van load of guys shouted at you, faggot! I was like, hi. Well, that was my last day there, actually. I was thinking, oh, it'd be nice to get home.
let's get to the nitty-gritty, because we had some breakthrough material on tonight, and that was the Canadian show House Calls, which actually explores people's sexual fantasies, and you get into this writhing pit of their sexual imagination, and you find out that they want to cover each other with chocolate sauce.
What's wrong with chains and, you know, handcuffs and a bit of rubber and a whip or something? I mean, I thought that was mild.
Yeah. It does emerge from your autobiography that what really thrills you is a cup of tea.
Well, tea is more reliable and it's less messy than chocolate sauce. I mean, imagine trying to get that off your sheets. And I find that tea is more reliable than men, usually.
Yeah. It's more English. You're actually a very British person.
that comment about tea has followed me. I mean, I said it on the Russell Harty show. And it was just, you know, because everyone was prying, what do you do, what do you do? And I just threw it out, you know. And it's followed me and it's got such, it's really like haunted me forever. But I do actually love tea. I mean, it's true, I actually do love a nice cup of tea and a chat. Because it can lead to other things, you know.
You're very, very nice to chat with, even if it doesn't lead to other things. Thank you very much, Boy George. To go now, but no show is truly over that ends with a song from our Latin American imported hand-rolled Havana soubrette Margarita Pracatan. Stand by for a tidal wave of emotion as she sings her song of defiance, I Will Survive. Vaya con Dios, Margarita Pracatan.
Oh, yeah, honey, we're going to survive this one. First I was afraid, I was petrified, and thinking I couldn't ever leave. wish I you by my side. But then it's been so many nights thinking what you did to me. I'm so strong and I learned how to get along, and now you're back. From out the space I just walk here to find your hair with that sad look on your face. I should have changed the stupid life. I should have made you leave your key. If I not for just 1 second, you come back to bother me. Gone now and gone. Walk out the door.